الحمد لله رب العالمين صلى الله وسلم على محمد وآله وصحبه وسلم. We have finished the Risala, the three ties, which is entitled The Six Events from the Sīrah of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. And the Shaykh رحمه الله, he mentioned those six events from the Sīrah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And since these treatise, it is a treatise that deal with the affairs of al-i'tiqad, the affairs of belief. The Shaykh rahimahullah ta'ala, he mentioned these events. And when we study these events, we study the reality of Tawheed and the reality of Shirk. Because if you want to know what Shirk is all about, then you have to know what Tawheed is all about. So, since we have concluded and finished this book, we would like to have a discussion, inshallah, about this risala, the six events from the Sīrah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Can any one of you share some of the benefits that you have learned in this Sīrah, in these six events? Now,
Abu Talib was not a Muslim, even though he believed with his heart and Muslimism was the best of religions.
Jazakallahu khair. We learned, Barakallahu Fiq, this is a very good point. We learned in this Sīrah that it is not enough to believe that this religion is the truth. But it has to be coupled with statement and actions. With statement and actions. And what Brother Taha is referring to is the statement of Abu Talib, the uncle of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he said, "Inni la'a'lamu anna deena Muhammadin min khayr al-bariyati deena. Lawla al-malamatu aw hadaru masabbatin lawajadtani bidaka samhan mubina." So basically what he said, "I know that the religion of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is the best of the religion of the creation. If it was not for the tribe that they were going to malign me and rebuke me and curse me out, I would have followed you. I would have submitted and followed you." But he didn't. He did not. When the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was at his deathbed, and he was encouraging him to say La ilaha illallah, he did not say it. He died upon the religion of his forefathers. So he died upon shirk. So that shows you right there that al-Iman is not only in the heart. And in this, there is a refutation against the deviant sect al-Murji'ah. Because al-Murji'ah, they are the ones that claim that al-Iman is only in the heart. And this is the al-Madhab of al-Jahmiyyah, al-Jahm ibn Safwan. He claimed that al-Iman is only in the heart. And al-Jahmiyyah, they claim al-Iman is in the heart. So this event refutes the falsehood that they are upon. And we can add to that, that Pharaoh, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he spoke about him in the Quran. When it comes to this particular issue, because we're trying to connect the dots, to come to the conclusion that al-Iman and the reality of al-Iman is not only in the heart, it has to be upon the tongue and the limbs. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he said about Pharaoh and those who were with him, he said, وَجَحَدُوا بِهَا وَاسْتَيْقَنَتْهَا أَنفُسُهُمْ ظُلْمًا وَعُلُوًّا. وَجَحَدُوا بِهَا. And they rejected the signs that Musa alayhi salatu wasalam brought to them. But he said, وَاسْتَيْقَنَتْهَا أَنفُسُهُمْ. While their soul was certain about it. So even though they believed, that the belief did not benefit them. Because that did not, you know, have any effect on their tongue and their limbs. So they did not comply with the commandment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And they did not testify that there is no deity worthy of worship except Allah. And they did not couple that with actions. So to believe in your heart is not enough. وَجَحَدُوا بِهَا وَسَيْقَنَتَ أَنفُسُهُمْ ظُلْمًا وَعُلُوًّا. And they rejected the signs while they were certain it is the truth. Why did they do that? He said, ظُلْمًا وَعُلُوًّا. By way of transgression and haughtiness, because they were haughty and they were very proud. They had a lot of pride and haughtiness. That's why they did not accept it. And they did not comply. Also, the ulama, they mentioned when they refuted the al-murji'a, they used also the example of Iblis. Because Iblis, he disbelieved because he refused to comply with the commandment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When he commanded him to prostrate to Adam, peace be upon him. But Iblis, he believed in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But that belief did not benefit him because he did not comply. He did not comply. And also this leads us to the statement of Al-Hasan Al-Basri rahimahullah. Anyone remember the statement of Al-Hasan Al-Basri? What Hassan al-Basri said about the Iman. Anyone remember?
Iman must be top of the actions.
Oh, he said, what is the statement? Anybody remember the statement of Hassan al-Basri? He said, لَيْسَ الْإِيمَانُ بِالتَّحَلِّي وَلَا بِالتَّمَنِّي وَلَكِنْ مَا وَقَرَ فِي الْقَلْبِ وَصَدَّقَتْهُ الْأَعْمَالِ. الْإِيمَانُ ليس الإيمان بالتمني والتحلي. الإيمان is not by way of wishful thinking. You just, you know, wish for it, but you don't do anything about it. That's not Iman. A lot of people, they're like this today. When you say, أخي, why don't you pray? And things like that. You say, إيمان, الإيمان في القلب. He said, Al-Iman is in the heart. Don't they say this? They say Al-Iman is in the heart. Okay, if Al-Iman is in the heart, it has to be coupled with actions. Because Allah said, Al-Ladina amanu wa aminu salihat. He did not say only Al-Ladina amanu, and he stopped. La. Al-Ladina amanu wa aminu salihat. Those who believe and do righteous deeds. So many people, they're like this. They say, don't judge me. They say, don't judge me. Al-Iman is in the heart. That's it. Okay, Al-Iman is in the heart, but it has to be coupled with action. So Al-Hasan al-Basri rahimahullah, he said, لَيْسَ الْإِيمَانُ بِالتَّمَنِّي وَلَا بِالتَّحَلِّي وَلَكِنْ مَا وَقَرَ فِي الْقَلْبِ وَصَدَّقَتْهُ الْأَعْمَالِ. Al-Iman is not by way of wishful thinking or embellishment. You can just embellish yourself and adorn yourself with it. But what settles, al-Iman is what settles in the heart, and actions confirm that. And actions confirm that. So it shows you right there, the madhab of al-Sunnah, walhamdulillah, qawlun bil-lisan, wa'atiqadun bil-qalb, wa'amalun bil-jawarih, yazidu bil-ta'a wa yanqusu bil-usiyan. That al-Iman is the statement of the tongue, belief of the heart, followed by actions of the limbs. It increases with good deed and decreases with sins. This is the madhab, walhamdulillah, wa al-sunnah wal-jama'ah. Unlike al-khawarij. Al-khawarij wal-mu'tazila wal-murji'ah. Al-khawarij, al-iman, according to them, does not fluctuate, does not go up and down. Likewise, al-murji'ah. Because al-khawarij, either you have it or you don't have it. So if you commit a major sin, you're kafir. You don't have it anymore. So they take you out of the fold of Islam because you committed a major sin. And that is due to their misunderstanding of the text. Because they did not understand the text correctly. So they thought that it is kufr akbar, that it is major kufr that take a person out of the fold of Islam. That's why they deviated. Al-Murji'ah, they don't consider al-Iman to go up and down or to fluctuate. Because they say al-Iman of the most righteous person is the same as the iman of the worst sinner. They're all the same. As long as you believe with your heart, you are a believer and you have complete iman, even if you commit sins, according to them. But this is batil. This is incorrect. Because al-iman goes up and down. When you do good deed, al-iman goes up. When you commit sins, al-Iman go down. Can anybody give us some of the evidence from the Quran or the Hadith about that al-Iman fluctuate? Anyone can give us? Na'am. Na'am. Wal-haya shu'batun min al-Iman. Ahsant. The statement of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, "Al-Iman bid'un wa sab'una shu'bah." Al-Iman is more than 70 branches. Al-Iman is more than 70 branches. The highest of which is the statement of Tawheed, that there is no deity worthy of worship except Allah. This is the highest of Al-Iman. And the least of that Iman, least of it, is when you remove a harmful object from the road. You see like a broken bottle. You see like a nail. Someone is going to step on it. They're going to go to the hospital to have stitches and the like. So you remove it from the road. This is from Iman. And this is an action of the limbs, because you remove it with your hand. And then he said, وَالْحَيَاءُ شُعْبَةٌ مِنَ الْإِيمَانِ. And modesty, to have modesty, is from al-Iman, is a branches from the branches of Iman. And this one has to do with the actions of the heart. With the actions of the heart. Because the actions of the heart, al-Iman, is from the actions of the heart. And also from the actions of the limbs. And also from the statement of the tongue. Because when you say, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, this is a statement of the tongue. And when you believe in it, that's al-Iman in your heart. And also you have to comply with that. You have to comply. You pray, you fast, you perform al-hajj, and other than that. الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ. Those who believe and do righteous deeds. أَيْنَعَمْ. Anything else have we benefited, barakallahu fikum, from those six events that somebody can share with us? نعم. تفضل. Yes, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the first thing he started with, he was calling the people to tawheed. He was calling the people to tawheed. And can anybody give us some ayat or a hadith about this affair? Anybody can give us some proof from the Quran about that, the first thing that the messengers, peace be upon them, call to is Tawheed. Where do you find in the Quran? Anybody has any proof and evidence for us? Anybody? Naam, tafadda. Ahsant. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَقَدْ بَعَثْنَا فِي كُلِّ أُمَّةٍ رَسُولًا أَنْ يَعْبُدُ اللَّهَ وَاجْتَنِبُوا الطَّاغُوتَ. And we have indeed sent in every nation a messenger. This messenger, he conveys to this nation to worship Allah alone and to stay away from false deities. So all the messengers, that was their job, that was their call. They call the people to Tawheed. But now, why do they call to Tawheed? Why do they start with Tawheed? Why? Anybody can tell us why do they start with Tawheed? Yes. No doubt, because the people, they were worshipping idols, they were idol worshippers and the like. But yes, that's one reason. But do you have, why do they specifically call it Tawheed? Why? Naam, because that's what rectifies people in the society. And also, a tawheed is the foundation. The foundation. That's why the ulama, they call it usul al-deen. The fundamental principle of the deen. Without tawheed, the salat is not going to be good. It's not going to benefit the person if his tawheed is not good. If someone performed the five daily prayers, and he makes qiyam al-layl, and he fasts, and he does, oh, he gives zakat, and he does charity and all that. But when calamity hits, he doesn't turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He turned to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Like it is in one of the books of Adhkar, some people have, there's the ignorant people, Muslim countries, where I mentioned the khutbah, like Salat al-Taj. I don't know if you're familiar with Salat al-Taj. They call it Salat al-Taj. It's a Sufi book of al-awrad, adhkar and awrad, and then they call upon the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They say, "O repeller of calamities, a'udhu billahi min dalik." The only one that can repel calamities is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And look, when they become extreme, and they go overboard, and they don't respect the text, they don't respect the statement of the Messenger of Allah, then they go overboard and they become excessive. Because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, لا تطروني كما أطرت النصارى عيسى بن مريم. Do not be excessive when it comes to praising me, as the Christians did with Isa, the son of Mary. They went overboard, and what happened? They began to worship him. They began to worship him. So now we have some Muslims, unfortunately, they, instead of calling upon Allah, they're calling upon the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And the best example in Qasidat al-Burda, which is a Sufi, Qasida that is chanted when they celebrate al-Mawlid, the birthday of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And in the beginning of al-Qasida, this Qasida, the al-Busiri, he said, Ya Sayyid al-Khalq, مالي من ألود به سواك. He said, يا سيد الخلق, O master of the creation. He's talking to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. He said, O master of the creation, I have no one to turn to at times of calamities and at times of hardship. Isn't this shirk or not? This is shirk. Because now, he, instead of calling upon Allah, he's calling upon the Messenger of Allah to help him out. And in Tanta, in Egypt, there is a shrine. It's called the Shrine of Sayyid al-Badawi, well known. And Sheikh bin Baz mentioned this, rahimahullah. He mentioned this, that they call upon al-Badawi. They call upon him. They say, madad, madad, ya Badawi. Madad, madad, ya Badawi. They say, oh, Badawi, madad, madad, help me out, help me out. So this al-Badawi, this man who is buried, he cannot even hear them. And even if he was to hear them, there is nothing he can do.
there is nothing he can do. Even if he was still alive, there is nothing he can do to help those people. The only one that can help them is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So now when you call upon someone else, then you're committing shirk. What the brother said, Brother Abdullah said, that tawheed rectifies the society. That's exactly what it does. Because when we are not on the same belief, then we're going to have sect. We're going to have sect, right or wrong. We're going to have sect. Like, for example, the aqidah of al-murji'ah. And then you have al-jahmiyya. Then you have al-mu'tazila. Then you have al-asha'ira. You see? Now you have different sects. You see? Because they're not on the same page when it comes to tawheed. When it comes to tawheed. And also we learn from this that the first affair that the Prophet ﷺ called to is tawheed. Because he remained in Mecca for how long? 13 years. He used to go to public places and markets and the like, and he used to tell them, قُولُوا لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ تُفْلِحُوا. Say لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ and you will prosper. You will prosper. Say لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ تُفْلِحُوا. You will prosper. You will be successful. Because التوحيد is the success. And that's why the ulama, they say, مَنْ حَقَّقَ التَّوْحِيدِ دَخَلَ الْجَنَّةَ بِغَيْرِ حِسَابٍ. أليس كذلك؟ نعم. إذن ulama, they said, مَنْ حَقَّقَ التَّوْحِيدِ whoever actualizes tawheed, whoever actualizes tawheed, he will enter al-jannah without any reckoning. Without any reckoning. So how can a person actualize tawheed? How can he do that? Yeah, he fulfills the conditions of la ilaha illallah and he complies with the commandment of Allah and all that. This is tahqiq tawheed. But someone, he says, ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu anna Muhammad Rasulullah. And then he calls upon Sheikh Abdul Qadir al-Jailani. Did this person actualize his tawheed? He did not. He did not. So now, up till now, we have so many shrines in Muslim land. In India, in Pakistan, in Bangladesh, in Egypt, in Morocco. I mean, many, many Muslim countries, unfortunately, we have the shrines of so-called al-awliya. And these shrines, they have seasons where people go there. You're talking about thousands of people converge to this shrine. And they go there, they make their vows, they circumambulate the shrine. They go around it like you when you make tawaf around the Kaaba, they do the same thing. ويتمسحون بالضريح. And they rub themselves against the shrine. And they bring candles. They put candles in there. And they put a kiswa, like a clothing, on top of the dome of the shrine. Yeah, you have seen them, right? You know what I'm talking about. And I have seen something. I have witnessed it. But I was not part of it, but I saw it from the outside. But I'm going to tell you what I've seen. And I mentioned this, and I want those who experience something like this to share with us, because this is a bitter reality. This is a bitter reality of many of the Muslims, unfortunately. They don't understand the reality of tawheed at all. They don't know what tawheed is. But they will know about celebrities. They will know every celebrity. Soccer players. They will know their names. But when it comes to tawheed, they don't know anything about it. You know, in my country, one time I was in this city called Al-Jadida. And this city is a coastal city. A lot of people go there, you know, for, you know, relaxation, for a picnic, things like that. So we went to by the seaside. Families come there, they picnic. Nobody swims, just the sea. It's a very beautiful view. And it was like winter. And the minute we sat down to have our lunch, I had my brother, my sister there. So I looked like this. I looked around. I saw the shrine. SubhanAllah. I was like, what is going on here? So there was a shrine. So I asked my sister, I said, who's buried here? She said, there's a lady buried here. Her name is Aisha. So I told her, what's her story? So she said, according to the folklore, like what the people say, if this is true, Allahu A'lam, but they're saying about this lady that she fell in love with a man from Morocco. But because of the politics, the parents didn't want her. Because she was madly in love with him, she decided to come anyway. So she came. And she wanted to go to the other city where this man is. Actually, this guy is also buried. They have a shrine of him too. This is very ajeeb. So his name is Shu'aib. So now she wanted to swim because there is a river there. There's a river. It's called Umm Rabi'a. So she wanted to swim across the river. She drowned and she died. Now the ignorant, what they did, they made a shrine for this lady. And now, because this lady, look how shaitan, subhanAllah, the shaitan, he will not leave the people alone. Because this lady, her purpose, why she came to get married to this man, right? She wanted to marry him. And now these fools and this ignorant, so they made a shrine for her. And all these idiots, I'm sorry to say that, and those ignorant women, you know, they want to get married. And they're having a hard time getting married. Instead of asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and making dua, they come into this lady. You'll be shocked. They're coming from all over the country. All over the country. So I was very curious. I was like, what in the world is happening here? So I go and I see this wall around the shrine. And this wall is like a historical figure. It's like a monument. And it has names of females all over the wall. Naima, Ruqayya, Fatima, Sumayya, you name it, they have it. Okay, so I went to this vendor, I said, brother, why these ladies come in here? He said, Akhi, these ladies, they are very superstitious. Because they claim they have been cursed. Someone put a curse on them. That way they can't get married. They're having a hard time getting married. So they come to this lady to release the curse. Wal'iyadu billah. Tell me if this is not shirk. Billah. So these ladies, they come to this lady. I told my sister, wait a minute. She did not get married. How is she going to get them married? She started laughing, you know. This is very ajeeb. Very ajeeb. So they come. this is strange. So they come there, right? They go inside, and there is a basin. You know, as long as there are fools out there, crooks, you know, they use people's money, say, give us some money and things like that, and they are collecting their money. They give them money. They will give them because they believe that they're going to be cured. SubhanAllah. And this is a calamity. This is the calamity. Wal'iyadu billah. So they come in there. They wash. They say when you wash, then the curse and the spell, you know, the magic spell will be washed away. So when they come out, they write their name. Now I get it. They write their name on the wall. So after they write their name on the wall, they put henna in their hand. They say, okay, this is a good omen for you. You're going to get married now. This is the most ajeeb. It's like Hinduism, right? It's like Hinduism. This is very strange. But it's happening and taking place in Muslim countries. Nobody can tell me that I've seen it. SubhanAllah. I've seen this thing. It's unbelievable. How ignorant so many Muslims are. So that's why Tawheed is extremely important. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us all al-ilm al-nafi', al-amal salih, alhamdulillah rabbil alameen, sallallahu wa sallam ala Muhammad wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallim. The time is up. Anybody has a question? We were having a discussion, so we shouldn't have questions, right? Okay. Alhamdulillah rabbil alameen, sallallahu wa sallam ala Muhammad wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallim.